I'm Josh Liston from On The Bubble Podcast, an oral history of television fandom, part of the Gunner Geek Network, just like the show you're checking out now. Shows on the network are individually owned and opinions expressed may not reflect others. Find other awesome geeky shows at gunnergeeknetwork.com.
Welcome to Hot Hero Summer, brought to you by Smoking and Drinking in Space and Smoking and Drinking in Capes.
We will be simulcasting weekly straight to your ear holes all summer long, so you can catch all the Heroes episodes on either feed thanks to the miracles of black magic and, my favorite, time travel.
Wow.
Solar eclipse.
Yeah. Yeah, I wonder if it's going to be total.
Not here, no. Some other part of the world, yes. A global event. Makes one appreciate just how small our planet really is. And we're all quite small, really, aren't we?
What's your name?
Mohinder.
I'm Peter. Let me ask you something, Mohinder. Do you ever get the feeling like you were meant to do something extraordinary?
Driving a cab, you may have noticed.
No, I'm not talking about what you do. I'm talking about who you are. I'm talking about being special.
Yes, we are all special.
That's not what I meant.
Some individuals, it is true, are more special. This is natural selection. It begins as a single individual, born or hatched like every other member of their species, anonymous, seemingly ordinary. Except they're not. They carry inside them the genetic code that will take their species to the next evolutionary rung. It's destiny.
Everyone, and welcome to Smoking and Drinking in Space. This is a sci-fi podcast from a couple guys who think they know sci-fi. And this week, we start the Hot Hero Summer discussing the show that answers the question, what if the most annoying people in the world had superpowers? Starring Hayden Panettiere, Milo Ventimiglia, and Jack Coleman. It's Heroes Season 1, Episodes 1 through 6. Oh my God, I made it through all those names. Barely. But first, he's the time-bending fanboy who gets his deepest wish granted and then fucks it up every chance he gets. It's Rob. How are you doing, Rob?
Doing good. It's like we're on the same wavelength because you can time travel, but only twice a year, and it's only an hour each time.
What?
Daylight savings time, buddy.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. You really can't time travel. You're a moron.
Yeah.
So I'm a little confused.
That's your normal state, though. So
yeah. Well, I'm a little confused because this is Hot Heroes Summer.
Hot Heroes Summer.
Apparently, we're recording SaDiS.
Yes.
Smoking and Drinking in Space, sci-fi.
Yeah.
The title is, of this thing is Heroes. Shouldn't it be on Smoking and Drinking in Capes?
Well, the funny thing about that is the next episode is going to be on Smoking and Drinking in Capes.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I forgot about that.
Epic summer crossover that nobody asked for.
But you're getting it anyway.
That's right.
And I just want to let you know, we are suffering for our fans. Six episodes is rough.
It is.
Especially in the time frame we have.
Yeah. Six episodes. Yeah. Six episodes an episode for each show. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a commitment. And we've got four seasons that we're going to be going over.
And I think there's only like one of our recordings where it's less than six. It's like five.
Yeah. It took a couple weeks of planning to get everything kind of mapped out.
Dude, I had to get the abacus out. I think I had the Ouija board out at one point. I mean,
yeah, we were divining the spirits to see if we were going to be able to do this. Yeah.
Yeah, but we figured it out, sir. We figured it out.
We did.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So since this is, we've got a lot of ground to cover and not a lot of time to do it in, we are going to be foregoing the news during this series. So no news this summer.
No.
But that's okay. What?
I have news. I came with news.
And? I'm letting you off the hook. The one time that you actually come forward, you probably have actually decent news this time. You don't get to do it.
I have space news.
You always have space news.
Yeah, but this is good space news. But that's okay, because my space news will probably be old news, like more old news than it normally is on SaDiC, because it's March.
Yeah. So we're trying to get a head start here by starting our recordings in March. Thanks for letting people peek behind the curtain here.
That's all right. Our next episode, we're going to record in May.
That's true. Yeah.
No, it's not. I think it's like in 2 days.
Yeah. It's not long.
Yeah. Well, the first season is like going to be done in March, but then we don't do like the second season until like
late April.
First of May. Yeah. Late April, early May. We had to get a head start. I mean, again, 6 episodes every time is rough.
It is.
And still recording for the stuff that you've already listened to.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Time because, travel?
Because we're recording several episodes in parallel now.
Yeah. Yeah. It's been a fun week.
It's going to be a fun next 2-3 weeks.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah. I looked at that calendar. I was messed up. All right.
All right. So another thing is the normal ladies that we have that read off of our pod crawls every week, they're going to be on vacation this summer. So, really,
they didn't want to do it.
They just didn't want to do it. Yeah. Let's be honest. They just didn't want to do it because, and we didn't really want to pay the extra to get them to do it. So,
overtime.
Yeah. So what we've done is we've had a ghostwriter come up with the pod crawls, their initials. I'm not going to give them their name because they asked for anonymity. Yeah.
Right.
Because, you know, it's this show and they didn't want their name associated with this show, but their initials are CG the third. So what they've done is they've written the pod crawl and we're going to be flipping back and forth. So I will read the pod crawl on my show. Rob will read the pod crawl on his show. I have not seen this pod crawl yet. So CG the third has emailed this to Rob. Rob is going to put this in the super secret chat cave whenever it's time to do the pod crawl. And I will be reading it cold. So I have no idea what I'm going to be reading before I read it. So there's a little bit of risk here because there's no telling what in the hell Rob has told them to write.
Yeah, so a little caveat on this one. They wrote for 6 episodes. Unfortunately, episode 6 had nothing to do with episode 6. It had more to do with like an episode later. So I'm going to omit episode 6 because it's like giving you spoilers for, you know, 2 or 3 episodes in the future.
Awesome.
So you're only getting a pod crawl synopsis of the first 5 episodes.
Okay.
That should be more than enough.
Okay.
So,
well, let's just rip off the Band-Aid and get this done.
We can call it, I don't know, say a pod crawl. The pod crawl. Pod crawl. Pod crawl. Pod crawl. Excellent. Insert it deep. Pod crawl. Kind of like a space suppository full of information.
All right, let's do this. Episode 1. In the first episode of Heroes, we meet a bunch of random people who somehow discover they have superpowers. There's a cheerleader who can heal any injury, a politician who can fly, and a guy who can bend time and space. They don't quite know how to control their powers yet, but they're all pretty excited about it. Unfortunately, there's a serial killer on the loose who seems to be targeting people with superpowers, so they'll have to figure out how to use their abilities to stop him. If they can stop bickering and getting into silly arguments long enough to work together. It's like a dysfunctional family reunion, but with more explosions.
I don't remember an explosion.
Episode 2. In episode 2 of Heroes, we see the main characters struggling to come to terms with their newfound powers. Hero is still trying to figure out how to time travel without ending up in a completely different century, while Claire is busy testing out her invincibility by jumping off tall buildings and getting hit by cars. Meanwhile, Peter is having a tough time controlling his ability to absorb other people's powers, leading to some hilariously awkward moments where he accidentally gains new abilities at the most inconvenient times. And let's not forget about Mohinder, who spends the entire episode looking pensive and brooding while cryptically talking about his father's research. We get it, dude. You're supposed to be the deep and mysterious one. Overall, the second episode of Heroes is a lighthearted romp through the early days of these unlikely heroes' journeys, filled with plenty of laughs and quirky character moments. Just don't think too hard about the actual plot, or you might start to get a headache. Episode 3. In Episode 3 of Heroes, we start to see some serious character development. We learn that Hiro Nakamura really just wants to be a big bad superhero like the ones he's read about in his comic books. Unfortunately, his powers are a bit more underwhelming. Meanwhile, Claire Bennett is dealing with some major teenage angst. She can't seem to figure out how to be a normal high school student, what with her ability to regenerate body parts and all. Plus, she's got some serious daddy issues as her adoptive father seems to be keeping some major secrets from her. Finally, we end the episode with a cliffhanger as Hiro and his sidekick Ando teleport themselves to New York City, where they witness a nuclear explosion. Will they be able to save the day? Tune in next week to find out. I don't remember Ando being there.
I don't either.
Episode 4. In Season 1, Episode 4 of Heroes titled Collision, the characters find themselves in a series of, well, collisions. Hiro Nakamura, the time-traveling hero from Japan, accidentally teleports himself into a woman's bathroom stall, resulting in some awkward and hilarious confusion. Meanwhile, Claire Bennett, the indestructible cheerleader, attempts to save a man from a burning car, only to accidentally throw him through a windshield and knock him unconscious. Whoops! What happened?
I think he was watching a different season.
You think so? Yeah. To make matters worse, Matt Parkman, the cop with telepathic powers, collides with a wall while attempting to read someone else's mind, leaving him with a concussion and newfound appreciation for helmets. And let's not forget about Peter Petrelli, the empathic nurse with the ability to absorb other heroes' powers. In this episode, he accidentally absorbs his brother's power of invisibility, yeah, resulting in some comical hijinks as he struggles to control his new ability. This guy is just making shit up at this point.
I think he is.
In the end, our heroes manage to sort out their collisions and continue on their journey to save the world, but not without a few laughs along the way. Episode 5. In Season 1, Episode 5 of Heroes, titled Heroes, that's H-I-R-O-S, our heroes continue to explore their abilities and their place in the world. Hiro Nakamura, the time-traveling hero from Japan, continues to struggle with his controlling powers. He teleports himself and his friend Ando to present-day New York City and meets up with a comic book artist named Isaac Mendez. Isaac's paintings depict the future, including Hiro and Ando's journey to America.
Not yet.
Meanwhile, Claire Bennett, the indestructible cheerleader, deals with high school drama as she tries to fit in with the popular crowd while keeping her abilities a secret. We also see the return of Matt Parkman, the cop with telepathic powers, who is working with another hero, Ted Sprague, who has the ability to emit radiation. Matt tries to teach Ted how to control his powers, but their partnership is strained due to Ted's anger issues. Okay.
I don't remember that.
It comes later, I think. I don't think that was episode 5.
That's other seasons. Or other episodes, yeah.
Yeah. And Peter Petrelli, the empathic nurse, continues to absorb other heroes' powers and gains the ability to fly, but struggles to understand his role in saving the world. As the episode ends, the heroes begin to realize their abilities may be part of a larger plan, and that their destinies are intertwined. Heroes sets up the rest of the season with its intriguing storyline and character development. And from what I understand, he is just way off the ball on episode 6. So we're not gonna read that synopsis. But
yeah, he started to go off the rails on episode 5.
Yeah, maybe we should reevaluate his contract.
Yeah. I tried so many different ways to get him to stay on track. It didn't work.
All right. So, Heroes, Season 1, Episodes 1 through 6, beginning the hot heroes summer crossover for this summer. What do you think of Heroes? You've seen this series before, right?
Yes. I watched this series when it first came out on good old NBC.
Yeah.
I also have the first season DVD. I totally forgot how slow 2000s TV series were.
Yeah, well, I mean, they've got, 23 episodes to fill?
Yeah.
This was back in the day where you still had 23-episode seasons. They were split between the fall and spring seasons. So it was like 11 and 12 episodes respectively. So 23, 24 episodes per season, depending on if you did like a 1 hour or 2 hour pilot or beginning episode, things like that. So yeah, they have a lot of time to get to their plot points.
Yeah. I mean, it's still decent. It does have some issues, but I mean, I'm going to keep watching it.
Well, you don't have a choice.
Yeah. Well, that's true. But I mean, it's not like I'm like, oh God, this is going to be the longest. Well, I mean, this is going to be the longest summer ever, but only because of the sheer volume, not necessarily because the TV show didn't age well. I think it aged okay.
The first season so far has aged pretty well. And this was one of the first TV shows that really did a serialized story. I mean, a fully serialized story. There were some previous shows that did kind of a serialized story in an episodic content. Babylon 5 was kind of one of those that did this overarching story arc with episodic content.
Lost was kind of
Lost
like that.
Was serialized.
Lost came afterwards, though.
No, Lost came before this.
Did it?
Yeah.
2000, because 2004.
Lindelof had done Lost already, and
Well, Lost had already started. Heroes started in 2006. Lost started in 2004.
Right, right.
So, yeah.
But Tim Kring, I want to say, helped Lindelof get out of his contract at NBC so he could go do Lost at ABC.
Gotcha. So, I mean, yeah, so the serialized thing is kind of interesting. I don't remember a lot of shows prior to this that had that. You had maybe two-parters, sometimes three-parters, but you didn't necessarily have, you know, it wasn't a, if you didn't watch, you're kind of screwed sort of thing.
Yeah.
So.
Most shows up until even this time at 2005 or 2006 were still very much episodic.
What'd you think?
I'm enjoying it so far. Like you said, it is definitely a slow burn because they have a lot of time to kill in these episodes. So these are 45-minute episodes because they had to fill an hour slot. And this is on network TV, so you have commercials. So they're about 45 minutes each. And there's 23 of them in season one. So you're looking at around 20 hours worth of content. That's a lot of content that you're having to fill for a single season.
Right.
Whereas today we get, 50-minute episodes, 10 episodes max for a season.
Typically, yeah. I mean, there's still shows out there that are doing more episodes, but that's more like dramas and things like that.
I don't even think network TV anymore really does like Grey's, 22 to 24.
Grey's Anatomy, not 24 or whatever. In fact, let's look. Actually, the one that I'm really thinking about is there's 911.
But those are all still very episodic.
Yes. No, serialized. No, not that long. but there's still seasons or series out there that do more than 10, but they are very much a episodic type of deal, or at the very least, sometimes, you know, maybe they refer back to a previous episode.
Sure.
But yeah, not serialized. Yeah, no, you don't get much past 12.
Yeah. But no, I like it so far. One of the things that I like so far is that the powers aren't front and center. This is very much a character study kind of show. It's got a lot of different characters that you're trying to keep track of, but they're doing a really good job of fleshing out these characters and how they're dealing with these newfound powers. There's still a huge air of mystery around how they got these powers, what these powers, you know, mean. You know, who is the horned rimmed glasses guy? Things HRG. Like that. Yeah, HRG.
HRG.
So
I remember that on all of the synopsis and all that kind of stuff. It was always HRG.
Yeah. So they're doing a really good job of keeping the interest going, keeping the mystery going so far. Now, we're only going through 1 through 6. I think I've watched through 11 so far.
Oh, damn. You're way ahead of me. I'm on 7.
Yeah, I've watched through 11 so far, so I've got to remember to only talk about what happened up to
episode 6. Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I hadn't gone very far, but I'm going to start doing that, and I'll keep notes in terms of, okay, this is where I'm at.
Yeah.
You know, to try to keep me from thinking too far ahead, because I know what happens.
Sure, yeah.
But...
So our main characters so far are Claire Bennett, which is the cheerleader, played by Hayden Panettiere. And we've got Peter Petrelli, which is played by Milo Ventimiglia. We've got the horn-rimmed glasses guy.
You did that one right this time.
Yeah, well, I'm not trying to to read it off the page and go as fast as I can. We've got the horn-rimmed glasses guy, which is...
That's...
Jack Coleman, his character's name is actually Noah Bennett.
Yes.
Yeah, I was trying to think of his character's name. And then we've got Hiro Nakamura, played by Masioka. Isaac Mendez, played by none other than Captain Cristobal, Santiago Cabrera.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
He looks totally different.
I was going to say, he does not look like...
He looks totally different.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, granted, this was, you know, almost 20 years ago, or almost...
Yeah.
No, almost 10 years ago.
Still, I mean...
No, almost 20 years ago.
Yeah.
2005, yeah, almost 20 years ago.
But you got people like Greg Grunberg, who still looks like Greg Grunberg. You know, he still looks the same.
Yeah.
Years later. Allie Larder still looks the same. Just a little older.
A little bit.
But, I mean, for the most part, yeah.
Yeah, so Greg Grunberg is playing Matt Parkman. He's a telepath. Allie Larder is playing Nikki Sanders. She's, all we know is that she's got, like, some kind of super strength, and she's a little bit fucking nuts.
She blacks out and wakes up.
She's got
up
a couple
like
different
death.
Personalities.
Yeah.
And then we've got Sindel Ramamurthy, who's playing Mohinder Suresh. And he doesn't actually have superpowers, but his father is the one who's done research on these superpowered people. And so he's the one that's kind of chasing his father's research to try and figure out what's going on.
Yeah. Is there anybody else? Well, we got Ando doesn't have powers, but he's pretty.
Yeah, he's
kind of a main character.
He's Hero's sidekick,
right? The he's the translator.
Yeah, although Hero seems to be picking up English really, really quickly.
Yeah, yeah, it's Probably all the comic books he read or the shows that he watched.
Well, maybe, but at the beginning, so like in episode one or two, he was like, I don't speak any English.
That's true.
Yeah, it was when he was talking to the cops, whenever he went to the future and got apprehended in Isaac's apartment right before the explosion. He was talking to the cops. He was like, I don't speak English.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden he can.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Oh, well. So I already asked you this. So I know the answer, but there's two versions of the first episode out there.
Yeah.
There's the aired episode. And then there's the unaired pilot.
Uh-huh.
And those are on the DVDs and Blu-rays. You just happened to watch the episode one. I watched the unaired pilot. And I will tell you, if you've watched the unaired pilot and then you go into episode two, yeah, you're going to get confused.
Yeah, you probably have no idea what's going on.
Well, no, you do. The issue, though, is they changed some stuff up. So I will give you an example without moving too far into the future. In the pilot, we talked about it. Ted Sprague or whatever.
Ted Sprague, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Who is explosive.
Radiation or whatever, man, yeah.
Radiation man, yeah. We talk. It was in that pod crawl that... Mr. CG the third.
Right.
Stepped a little too far. He's in the pilot episode, the unaired pilot. And his name isn't Ted. He is actually a Arab descent.
Really?
Yes. He is of Arab descent. His body emits radiation, and in the opening thing, basically his family, he ended up killing his family because he emits radiation. And so they got sick and died from radiation poisoning. And he wants to kill himself, but some people find him and want to use him as a dirty bomb, basically the equivalent of a dirty bomb.
Gotcha.
Right. So he is caught by Parkman in the first episode. They catch him. The FBI catch him before anything can happen.
Interesting. Okay.
Siler is not a thing yet. So that was a bit of a difference. So you see that in the first episode, they did the whole scene with Parkman finding the little girl, switch that and have Parkman find the bomb dude in, under the stairs.
Interesting.
Yeah. So that was confusing. Not only for me, but for the wife. She started, I will tell you, she started watching this with me. She got to episode three and then decided she was out.
Why?
Well, it wasn't that she wasn't, she thought it was okay. It was a little slow. Her big concern is how many of these do we have to watch and how quickly? I'm like, look, it's going to be rough. And she goes, I can't do it. I can't keep up. I'm like, all right, fine. Cause I'm having to do two at a time, basically. Right. So we got a little confused. I got a little confused at first. Cause I'm like, man, why? Cause you get into episode two and it's repeating a lot of the other stuff that already showed up. I'm like,
right.
Man, what is going on? And then I started looking. I'm like, oh, damn it. Because I had the first season DVD. I had ripped it and put it on my Plex and things like that. To you know, I and I don't have a DVD player anymore. So I was watching it on the Plex, and then I went and got the DVD, and I start looking at it. I'm like, unaired pilot. I'm like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
I thought I was being cool. Another thing. Nikki's son, Ali Lauder's son, in the pilot, we find out that he's pretty damn smart.
Yep.
So like he rebuilds a computer board and things like that.
Yeah, he does that in the first episode too.
Right. We find out he's pretty damn smart, but he also leaves, gets an Uber, or the equivalent of an Uber, and goes to the prison to meet his dad.
Okay.
And that's where it ends.
So yeah, that's totally
that hasn't happened at all.
Well, I mean, he doesn't know where his dad is. That was the right. Whole thing is.
Yeah. Yeah. So they changed it up to where his dad had escaped or right. Wasn't around or what have you. Yeah. So there's a bunch of little different things. Honestly, based off of what I saw in the second episode, I think what they showed for the first was for the better. The unaired pilot showed too much. It showed its hand. It showed too much of its hand too soon.
Yeah. And it sounds like they changed quite a bit from the pilot to the first episode too.
Yeah. Yeah, they did. They did. Some of the stuff with Mohinder and his dad that got changed up. Just bits and pieces, not like the whole thing.
Right.
But I mean, they changed it up a little bit, but it was confusing to watch. After the second episode and I figured out what was going on, it moved along okay. And I'm back on track.
What is Micah? Micah, that's what...
Micah is his name, yeah.
Yeah, Micah. I was trying to... So, couldn't remember what in the hell his name was.
Yeah, and you brought this up, and it was a question that I had. How do their powers manifest?
So I think it has something to do with the eclipse, right?
The eclipse hasn't happened yet.
Has it not?
No.
Yeah, then I thought it happened in like the first episode.
Okay. So if there was an eclipse in the first episode, that was not in the unaired pilot. So, but that doesn't even track because there's people that have had their powers for a while.
Yeah, that's true because Peter's brother Nathan has had his powers
for quite a while.
For a while.
I mean, we'll find out later that there's some old people that have powers.
Claire's had hers for a while because she's been trying to kill herself for a while now.
Yeah, yep. Isaac has had his powers long enough to have a comic book written.
Oh, that's true. That and he did a future painting of the eclipse. So he would have had it before the eclipse.
Right.
Yeah. So I guess it wasn't the eclipse that was the catalyst for their powers showing up. Yeah. I don't know.
I mean, they're kind of insinuating that it's just a naturally occurring thing, but something's got to
why is it just emerging while they're like most of them are adults and there it all starts to happen at the same time.
Yeah, roughly the same time.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. I did like the use of the symbol, the F symbol or whatever it is.
It's a half. Yeah, half it's a half a helix.
Half a helix. I do like the use of that and where they've put it in, you know, it was in the algorithm as it was scrolling by.
Right.
Nikki's got a tattoo of it. It shows
up in the paintings.
Yeah. Peter doodles it after committing suicide.
Right.
Or trying to commit suicide, but kid's captured by his brother, but it wasn't really suicide, blah, blah, blah. I like that
Hero has it on his sword when he comes back from the future too.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's because I think the original dude had it, the samurai or whoever had it, on his sword.
Well, he was the samurai.
Yes, eventually, but yeah, we don't know that yet.
We'll find that out. I think
he hasn't gone to. Yeah, he hasn't gone to feudal Japan yet.
Right.
Despite how many times GP the Third tried to put it in every time he sent it to me. Like episode 3, Hero goes to feudal Japan. No. Episode 3, 4, Hero goes. No, dude. Fix it. So, there was some stuff that didn't quite it was kind of glaring. Glaring bloopers for me.
Like what?
Having watched this already and, doing this for this show. Nikki, digging for hours in the desert to bury some bodies. And the shovel that she uses is still squeaky clean when she's done.
Well, it's the desert. It's not like, the sand chrome, and the dirt is.
Dude, the chrome wasn't even like scuffed up. And if anything, we know that the desert.
Oh, God damn it.
It's dry. It. And I the hate sand you. Gets everywhere. That was totally not planned until I realized that I was talking about the desert. And then I said,
yeah.
Self?
Yeah.
Jason needs to hear it.
No. No, I didn't.
Yeah.
I didn't.
It's coarse and rough and it gets everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah, I hate you. No, I mean.
No, that was an actual gripe for me, though, was the shovel. It's like, dude, the shovel doesn't even look like it got used.
Yeah.
People.
And it was pretty predictable that she was the person that had double crossed her husband.
Yeah, because there's dead bodies out there.
Yeah, the dead bodies, spot. And that she was the one that kind of set up the car, and or it was her alter ego Jessica, as we'll learn in episode 6.
No, not 6.
Yeah, it's 6.
It's not 6.
It's 6.
We don't know who Jessica is. There's no name.
Yes, we do, because she introduces herself. At the end of 6, whenever her husband takes Micah.
I don't
takes Micah at the end of episode 6. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she has a conversation with herself in the mirror.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's right.
And says, just let me take over or let me handle this.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right. I forgot that about the conversation.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
So Jessica is the one who set all that up.
Yep. Yep. 2 million. She stole the 2 million or whatever.
And I watched this whenever it came out, and I watched it through the 4th season. I even watched the abomination that was Heroes Reborn for like the first 3 or 4 episodes.
Yeah. I never watched that.
It was horrible. I couldn't make it past the 4th episode.
It's a good thing we're not covering that one.
Yes. But yet. I don't remember what happens with Nikki's character.
So she gets...
Don't tell me.
No, I do know that she gets written off. She was written out in the 3rd season. So,
oh, wow. She made it to the 3rd season.
Right. So we're going to see her for a while.
I don't even remember her in the 2nd season.
Yeah, I don't either. But she was written out in the 3rd season. She remained though for all 4 seasons. Apparently she played a twin sister or something. Some bullshit like that. Cuz I was looking at Wikipedia, holder of all knowledge. Yeah.
This whatever. Unknown twin sister that was never mentioned until the 4th season, huh?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay.
Well, I would assume twin sister because, played by the same actress, looks the same, is a sister.
Yeah.
Therefore, must be.
So we're introduced to Siler, which is the big bad guy.
We don't know who he is yet.
No, we know who he is.
No, we don't.
Yes, we do.
No.
We know that there is a person out there called Siler and that he's killing people and cutting their heads off.
We haven't met him yet. Like,
we
in person.
We see him.
We see a shadow, or we see a, you know, from behind type of thing. But we never see him.
I thought we saw him. So when did Parkman and what's her face, the FBI agent, chase him?
So technically we see, well, that's weird. So technically he first appears in.
He appears in episode 2.
One Giant Leap, episode 3.
Okay, he's mentioned in episode 2 then.
Yeah, he's mentioned in episode 2. He apparently appears in episode 3, but I think in episode 3 he is just it is a different character in episode 3. It's Ian Quinn. So but that's because we see him from behind. We don't see his face.
So it must have been episode 4 or 5 then. Because after they save the girl, they're going to go and ask the girl some more questions.
We haven't saved the girl yet.
We've saved Molly. He does that in episode 2.
Oh, the little girl.
Yeah, gotcha. The little girl.
Sorry, yes.
When he saves the little girl. Because mm-hmm. Siler was looking for the little girl.
Right.
Siler comes back and comes looking for the little girl. Yes. They chase Siler into the boiler room. And Peter shoots him, but then he escapes. So that's when we first see Siler.
Right, but we never see his face.
Yeah, we do. We see his face a bit.
A bit, but it's not the same face. It's Ian Quinn. It's not Zachary Quinto.
Okay.
Who is actually Siler?
Are you sure?
Yeah, Zachary Quinto is Siler.
No, I know Zachary Quinto is Siler, but are you sure that wasn't Zachary Quinto in that episode?
According to Wikipedia, holder of all knowledge, Siler was portrayed by Ian Quinn in One Giant Leap because he is the stunt coordinator.
Oh, okay. So... It's still Zachary Quinto's character. It was just a stunt coordinator that portrayed him in that particular. You know, they get stunt people that look kind of like the actor that they're. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sure. Whatever. I am splitting hairs.
Yes, you are.
Because I can.
Yeah. No, we see Siler in episode 3.
Fine. Be that way.
We hear about Siler in episode 2. We first see him in episode 3.
Yes. Sounds good. If it must be that way.
And we don't know exactly what Siler's powers are, other than he can
slice heads open.
Yeah, he can slice heads open, and he's got some telekinesis of some sort.
Yep. That's all we know. I mean, there's more to him, but that's all we know.
Right. All right, so Quabbles?
The morgue scene with the rib cage sucked.
Yeah. Yeah, that didn't look also awesome, did it?
That was terrible. That was like, it's like they got somebody's 9-year-old to, hey, make a rib cage out of Play-Doh for us.
Did they air this in HD? I don't think HD was a thing.
HD was not a thing back then.
At least not over the air.
Right. It was technically it says it was released in 1080i.
Okay, so they were broadcasting this in
I don't
HD.
Think it was yeah, I don't think it was the first couple episodes though. because it's really bad. The first few episodes. Could be wrong. Maybe it's just, you know, my terrible, terrible backup job.
Well, you're watching this off of DVD rips, though.
That's true.
That's true. I'm watching this off of HD Blu-ray discs. Because I have all four seasons on Blu-ray. So it's actually in 1080p. But I was wondering if this was aired in HD way back in the day. I can't remember. I can't remember when they started having the HD boxes that you had to get to convert the analog to, or the digital to analog. So they remember whenever they went to digital broadcasting. So they could start airing HD content.
Right. You had to have those boxes.
Yeah, if you had an analog only TV, you had to get a box that would convert the digital into an analog.
Yeah.
Can't remember when those came out. I want to say it was around this time, though. May have been a little later. It may have been like 2008, 2009. Let me see if I can find that. Da-da-da-da-da. Yeah, I don't see anything right out in front on how it was broadcast. I'll look that up for next episode.
All right. Yeah, figure it out, dude.
No, it was 1080i. Yeah. It was broadcast in HD.
Yeah, that's what I said. Well, it says up there that it was released in 1080i. Now, most people didn't have a 16:9 TV back then.
An HD TV?
Yeah.
I did.
You did?
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember if I did. I don't think we did. Well, 2006.
Yeah, I remember. Well, I had a Samsung.
Yeah.
In fact, I had that Samsung up until, shit, I had that Samsung forever because we'd bought it like a year or two before.
Yeah.
And it just died like 2 years ago. So that thing lasted forever.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Yeah. I had it because, I moved out of the house in 2004. Yeah. 2004.
Yeah. I remember your parents inviting me to a party. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, and I had a flat screen TV at that point in time. Still have it. It's in the youngest kid's room.
You're making them use an ancient technology.
Oh, baby. It has got a nice, I'm not going to call it a burn in, but it does have a darker spot where all the colors are a bit darker.
Nice. Nice.
Yeah. I'm just waiting for it to get, dude. And it is heavy as fuck.
Oh, I know. I know. So was the Samsung.
Yeah.
And the Samsung was weird. It wasn't burn in, but it had some pixel lag. So if there was like a bright scene and then it turned to a dark scene, you still saw the ghost of the bright scene for a little bit. Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. 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 My 55 inch weighs less than the smaller 32 inch that the kids had.
All right. What other quabbles?
I mean, that was really it. You know, the shovel thing, the rib cage. You know, it wasn't, other than it's slow, but I don't consider that a I don't consider that a quabble, because I mean that's just kind of the pace that things went back then. You know, it wasn't. I mean, things are moving.
Yeah, it was definitely a slow burn. One of the quabbles that I have is it seems like they're trying to introduce a little bit too much mythology at once. So. And it's kind of convoluted the way that they're introducing it, especially in terms of the artwork that Isaac is producing.
Okay.
So the artwork that Isaac is producing is our future visions that he's having. But then he also does this comic book that basically is laying out Hero's entire plot line, right?
Right.
So it was a little bit confusing to me how that all worked. They didn't explain that well. I don't think they really explained that well. And it was almost like the comic book was there as just a way to cover up kind of writing themselves in a corner and pushing the plot along.
Yeah. And I seem to remember that there was a whole promotional push.
Yeah.
Heroes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this comic was part of that.
Yes. And that's another thing that kind of
you could log on to their website and read the comic.
Well, I think they actually printed comic books too.
Did they? Maybe they also, yeah.
Yeah. They had a comic book line that ran in parallel to the series.
Yeah.
And in fact, they introduced a lot of the characters that they would introduce in the show.
Oh, through the comic. That's right.
Yeah, they introduced the characters in the comics before they were introduced in the show. And in some ways, if you didn't read the comics, you were a little bit lost as to what was happening in the show. It wasn't as bad in the first season, but I think in seasons 2 and 3, it got really bad doing that. But yeah, there was a whole promotional campaign, a huge marketing push for this show whenever it first came out.
Yeah.
Yeah. Comics was part of it. They had a web series that was part of it. Yeah. Something else. What was the other promotion that they did? Yeah, Heroes Origins. That was supposed to air after the completion of the second season, but it didn't because of the writer's strike. So the whole Save the Cheerleader, Save the World was their tag for the first season. That was a huge marketing thing.
Yeah.
They were heavy into Comic-Con. The comic book series. Yeah. So there was a huge marketing push whenever this show came out. Heroes Unmasked was a series on BBC. That went behind the scenes of the production.
They had a whole world tour.
Yeah.
That they did to promote the first season. Yeah. They did a bunch of stuff.
Yeah. Heroes Evolutions. Digital extension of the series that explores the show's mythology.
Yeah. Okay. Here we go. Each week, NBC released a Heroes webcomic. The comics gave additional character background and plot information not shown in the television episodes. The graphic novels continued on a weekly basis during the show's 2007 summer hiatus. Wildstorm released and published them from November 7th, 2007, or published them on November 7th, 2007, which included the first 34 chapters or 34 issues. And then there was a second volume, 35 through 80, and a third would have been 81 through 103. But it didn't get released. There was a novel published talking about Charlie, who we'll meet eventually.
All right. Any other There's quabbles?
A bunch of stuff. No, not yet. I'm sure I'll have some for next month, next six, next.
Yeah, the only other quabble that I have is Hero is a bit annoying. I never really liked his character, but I mean, he gets better. But,
he was a little annoying at the beginning, and then I seem to remember liking him later after his tryst through time, you know, is a feudal Japan thing.
Yeah.
Which I don't know when that is, but I seem to remember liking him a little bit better. He got a little cooler.
I want to say that's season 2, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't remember. I just remember he's got a soul patch.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
you know you're cool when you had a soul patch in the early 2000s.
Yeah, I want to say that's season two, because that's also the season that George Takei comes in and actually teaches him how to use the sword before he floats himself into feudal Japan. Because it was season two that he talked about his hero, whatever that samurai was.
Right, yeah.
He tried to imitate the, you know, being that guy, and it turns out that he was that guy, but spoilers.
Ugh! Okay, I'm okay. I'll get over it.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Well, you got a haiku for us this week?
I do. Now, the question here is, so next week, I'm going to be hosting.
Yeah.
Are you going to do a limerick for me?
A limerick?
Or a haiku. I don't care. I'm not picky, but yeah. Are you going to do one of them for me?
I'll come up with something.
All right. Well, I only have a sound bite for either a haiku or a limerick. If you go with something different, I'm going to have to find something. You can do a sonnet.
I am not doing a sonnet.
Come on. I'll get you some Victorian music.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I'll do something. All right. So this one is titled Heroes Season 1, Episodes 1 through 6. Because I didn't come up with a catchy title yet.
Yeah, that's a really, really fun title that you got there.
All right, fine. This one is titled Where's My Super Suit? Sure, why not? All right, here we go. People with powers, we must save the cheerleader. Where's my Chianti? Where's my Chianti?
Your Chianti?
Look, I had to stretch it out a little bit. You know, fava beans and a nice Chianti.
Yeah, Chianti, not Chianti. Chianti.
Sorry, Chianti.
Chianti. Yeah.
All right. People with powers, we must save the cheerleader. Where's my nice, where's my Chianti? I still fucked it up, but yeah. Whatever.
It works. All right.
All right. Look.
Got any awards this week?
I literally wrote that 2 minutes before we started.
Oh my God.
We hadn't talked about it.
Great. Glad you're prepared.
Look, I didn't think about it until we started talking, and then it's like, okay, I got to come up with something. You know this. Yes, I have awards. Black Lung, go.
Who's got your Black Lung?
No, you first.
No, you first.
No, you first.
No, it's my show. You go first.
Fine. I'm giving it to Claire in the fire.
Claire in the fire.
Yeah, she was on fire.
Trying to remember if anybody smoked in this one.
I don't remember anybody smoking.
Don't either.
Mm-mm. Like, not even when they were playing cards in that back alley game.
Yeah, you're right. I'm going to give it to Honorary Richard Dawson then.
All right. Fine. Be that way.
All right. Who's your head lush?
So you could give it to the dudes, and you could give it to like Ando in the back alley, because, you know, he had a beer, but he had to go to the bathroom. But I gave it to Nathan Petrelli in Vegas, because he got fucked up and did it with Nikki.
I don't think he was fucked up when he did it with Nikki. I think
he wasn't. Yeah. He was a little tipsy, but he wasn't like totally messed up. But yeah, they were enjoying some alcohols.
Mine is going to go to Matt Parkman because he gets roofied at the bar kidnapped by Noah and.
And we haven't seen him since.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we've seen Matt since.
No, we have not. Oh, yes, that's right. He does come back. Like, he was gone for like 3 days or whatever.
Yeah.
Yep. But he doesn't know where he's been.
Have you watched this show?
Yes. That's what happens when you watch like the first two episodes. See, it's going to be better moving forward because I don't have to wait on the wife to be ready, because, you know, it was like one episode every other night. So I had to start watching this in like February.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So from now on, I'll be more fresh.
All right, player.
Peter Petrelli getting him some Simone right after she broke up with Isaac.
Yep, that's who's getting mine.
Yep. Yeah.
Perfect player. Perfect. Purple hippo.
Especially with that crooked smile.
Yeah.
Yeah. Purple hippo. You know, I'm just... For this one, I'm going to give it to Claire Bennett waking up in the morgue. It's splayed open.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one.
I mean, that, you know, the last thing she knows, she was about to get raped. And then the next thing she knows, she's on the morgue table.
She's got to have like either a super high pain tolerance or her ability like dulls the pain
the
pain.
Yeah, I think she doesn't feel the pain.
I mean, she feels she's uncomfortable.
Yeah, she feels it, but she doesn't. Yeah, it's like stubbing your toe.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. Have you ever stubbed your pinky toe?
Yeah, that sucks.
That's like the worst pain I have ever felt.
Yeah,
I think it's worse than childbirth.
Well, I wouldn't know. I've never given birth to a child.
But. Me neither, but it sounds good. And nobody can tell me otherwise.
Yeah, I think there's some people that might disagree with you a little bit.
No. But yeah, so I'm thinking it's like stubbing your toe or hitting your funny bone. You know, it hurts, but then it goes away, obviously, because, you know, she heals.
Right, yeah.
Oh, man, that disposal scene, dude, that was gnarly.
Yeah, that was really gross.
That was so gross. It did it on purpose.
Yeah.
Like, took the time to take her ring off.
Yeah. She's got some issues.
And what happens if it didn't come back?
Right. That was the one time it doesn't grow back. And now she's maimed. Yeah. Mine is going to go to Nikki. Having,
that's a good one.
Well, yeah, for waking up in a bloodbath from your alter ego, like ripping a couple dudes apart.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, that's, she's evil. Jessica is. Like, I mean, hey, I'm going to murder these dudes. Yeah, that's evil. But it's like a whole nother evil to go, I'm just going to lay here and make her wake up next to this.
Right.
I'm not going to go into the other house. I'm going to lay right here. Ugh. Ugh.
All right. Final thoughts.
Let's get going. Let's do the next seven. Yeah.
Next six. So the next six are going to be on Smoking and Drinking in Capes, although we'll be releasing both sets of episodes on either feed. So you can catch all the episodes on whichever favorite feed you want to.
Yes. Also, just as a caveat, or not a caveat, as a little extra side note, I believe I am checking real quick. Excuse me. Yep. There's that one. I believe. Oh, no, not yet. I take that back. But during this, I do want to say that during all this stuff, SaDiC will be releasing some double headers.
There's some summer movies that we'll be reviewing.
Right. Yeah, we want to review those and get them while they're good. I'll be sure to let everybody know when those are happening as we record these bad boys.
Sounds good. All right.
Sounds like fun.
Yeah. It's going to be a busy summer.
Yep. Yep. Good luck with Mr. GP the third.
CG the third.
CG the third. Sorry. CG the third. Yeah. Oh, man. I think I might have given it away. Jason.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you might have. All right. Yeah. Well, that's all we've got for this episode. Our intro and outro music is Welcome Home by Cambo. Podcrawl music is Snack Mix by Machette. If you like the show, please rate and review us on iTunes. You can leave us feedback on our Discord channel at smokinganddrinkinginspace.com/Discord. Or you can email us at smokinganddrinkinginspace@outlook.com. If you'd like to throw a few nickels our way, you can become a Patreon supporter by going to smokinganddrinkinginspace.com/Patreon. And make sure to visit Gonna Geek for more great shows at GonnaGeek.com. For this episode, I'm Jason.
I need to save the cheerleader.
If you save the cheerleader, you save the world.
I want to be a hero!
Oh, God. And we'll talk to you next episode.
Yeah, hold on. Let's apparently I can't give you the entire thing. It's too much.